Yeah, good evening. So we are doing two questions today. The first question is based on knowledge and wisdom, and the second one is based on sadhana. So the first question is, what is the difference between knowledge and wisdom? How do we differentiate in real life with example? Now, knowledge is the knowing of something. If I have to know something, that is called knowledge. Let us say if I can see a bird and I can identify it, if I can see an object and I can identify it, this is based on a lot of factors like memory, so on and so forth. So we have, in spiritual, we say that we have one sheath, a sheath which is a subtle body, a sheath which is a subtle body, and that is called the intellectual body. Now this is the repository of all the knowledge that you have in your life. Now this knowledge which you have is gathered from your this life alone. Whereas the perennial knowledge that you carry with you, now that comes separately. That knowledge is hidden most of the time. It's only when the time is right can that knowledge be revealed to you. So the intellect normally reveals that knowledge when a person does unfoldment. That means he is able to overcome his ignorances. That means layers and layers and layers of ignorance are slowly getting removed from him. That is a time when the real knowledge dawns on the person. The real knowledge is not distorted by what is called as Maya. Maya is what is known as illusory principle. Now, I know all these words are sounding very difficult to all of y'all, so let us try to understand them one by one so you get the clarity. Everything that you see, hear, touch, feel, experience in this world, in this universe, in the creation, is unreal. It is a creation of the potency of the Lord called Maya's potency. It is Maya. The Lord has created this illusory potency called Maya, and she rules the roost. So the moment you are born, Maya comes in play. Even the body which you start getting, that is the moment you start getting a body in the womb itself, Maya has already started playing the role. So how does this happen? Before birth, you are a free soul. You had the choice of not taking birth. That depends on your past lives again. So now that you have taken birth, you have come with a plethora of what is called as karmas, which is called the prarabdha karma. You have taken an entire truckload, bus load, whatever you call it, a load of karma has come to you, package deal. So you now go and get used to it. So depending on your karma, you have taken up a body. So what kind of body comes to you has been discussed before. So I'm not going to discuss what kind of body you get. So on the contrary, what we are going to say is, how does this intellect come into the picture back again? From your past life, you have brought the karma. The karma is also packaged with some knowledge. Then you have tendencies. Tendencies from your past lives. That has also been packaged in you. So with the tendencies and the karmas joined together, you are an entire deal. Now starts your birth, and from birth till wherever you are, you may be 30 years old, 40 years old, 50, you have gathered a whole load of impressions in this life. These impressions start from the basic knowledge that you might have gained. Starts from you are a boy or a girl, then you have a name, then you have parents, you have your country and so on and so forth. So you have taken this entire load and come to this point wherever you are. So what does this memory comprise of? The memory comprises of this life, whatever you have gathered, and a portion of the previous life in the form of what is called as tendencies, which are coming along with it, and the prarabdha karma, what you have come to spend. So these are the three things that you have gathered together. Now all these doesn't comprise wisdom. So I'm just discussing knowledge at the moment. So all this is knowledge. You have gathered it, and stored it in the form of what is called as your memory in some storage space. It is said that it is on the top of your head. The cerebrum, a portion of it contains some amount of memory. Various parts of the body also contain a lot of memory embedded everywhere. So you will find that this memory is nothing but inside, like knowledge. These are bits and pieces of knowledge, like you have bits and bytes in computers, you know. Same way, think about it, that this knowledge has been embedded inside of you. Now, what is this knowledge? This knowledge is purely material worldly. Why? Remember, you got covered by it when you were born. The moment you were born, you were covered by Maya. So you got a name, you got, you know, either you are a male or a female or whatever. So it has been decided. Please remember this. Prior to it, you did not have any feminine or masculine qualities. You were not having anything like that. It's only at birth that you got a name, you got parents, and you came with, you know, an entire package deal. You come out. Were you expecting that? No, you are not expecting, but you are now brainwashed into thinking that this is your father, this is your mother, this is your brother, sister, whatever. And you have to accept it because you have no choice. If I consider today's day and age, and there is a child born to a surrogate mother, the person who provided the sperm is different, the person who provided the egg is different, it was created in a petri dish in some place, some laboratory, and then it was transferred to the surrogate mother, and now the child is born. And imagine this child gets adopted by somebody else. So who is the mother? Who is the father? Who are the relatives? Can you give an answer to this? There is no way in knowing who is the mother. Is it the one who provided the womb? Her womb was on hire. She's a surrogate mother. The one who is taking care of you? That is your foster mother. The one who provided the egg? She is a nobody because she just gave the egg as an experiment and went away. The one who brought the sperm and egg together in the laboratory in a petri dish? That man or that woman is your mother? I mean, think about it. Who is your mother? So what gives you the right in thinking that I have a mother, I have a father, just because somebody has given me a sperm and an egg? Doesn't give us that understanding. So this is the dichotomy which a child faces. Now let us talk about, now let us say the birth is perfect, there is a father and a mother, and then something strange happens. The father and the mother divorce, the father goes and marries someone else, the mother goes and marries someone else, the father undergoes another divorce, he marries somebody else. Now how many mothers and how many fathers is this person going to have? It's a very big dilemma for the human being. First and foremost, he's not able to handle his own life. He doesn't even know what he's doing. Now, whom to call mother, whom to call father, and what is he supposed to do? Where is he supposed to stay? It's a big, 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 big question mark. So do you understand? This is illusory world. This is called the world of Maya. And now all the knowledge that I have given you just now, whatever you got as an understanding and a knowledge, has zero value. Did you see that? Has no value at all. A poor boy or the poor girl is looking for a mother or a father. There you have it. And nobody is the mother, nobody is the father. So did you get the understanding over here that we have now entered a domain or a world where who is the real father or the mother? What were you before you were born? Go backward into the womb and beyond that. What were you before you were born? You have taken maybe thousands and thousands of birth. So you may be saying that I must be having over thousands and thousands of mother and father. Some of them may be bats, some of them may be cats, some of them may be birds, some of them may be animals, and I don't know. Some creatures, because you could have been born anyone as a creature also. So there, this is the place where you got to stop, and then let us look at wisdom. The wisdom is that knowledge which tells you that you actually don't have any parents. There are no parents. There are no relatives. Okay? You are that jeev atma who got trapped in the body. You are a jailbird. Right? You are a jailbird who got trapped in a body, and because you got trapped in a body, everybody who is next to you becomes your relative. And now you may have a twin brother or a twin sister or whatever inside, right there inside next to you, and you may be playing cricket over there for all you know in the womb. So do you really think that is your sister or that is your brother or whoever? That again is wrong, because that is another jivatma over there. So these two jivatmas are trying to come out in the world, and they have already started their sibling rivalry right there in the womb. Okay, who is going to eat more? Who is going to drink more? It is going on over there. So, you have not actually a body. A body is like a piece of cloth that you are wearing. You have taken that cloth and you have worn it only for that period of time. Then you throw it, then you take another one, then you throw that one, you take another one, then you throw that one, take another one. Goes on and on and on. So every lifetime when you take up a new body, you are a jivatma who takes up a body. So this is called knowledge. Is it visible to us? No way. Knowledge tells us that there is way beyond what we actually understand in the normal world. The normal world is illusory. Everything is illusory. And beyond the illusion is the real knowledge. Beyond the illusion is the real knowledge. The knowledge that you are a jivatma who has taken up this body and you have taken up this womb. It is like a delivery vehicle. Okay? Like SpaceX. You got delivered into International Space Station. It doesn't mean that, you know, you are some relative of yours is sitting over there and now you are going to some space station and then, oh, I am meeting my long lost relatives. There is nothing like that. They are all from different countries. Correct? So now, you got delivered. You are gone over there. What is the truth over here? द ट्रूथ इज यू आर दैट स्पिरिट सोल, जीव आत्मा. नाउ वेयर डिड दिस जीव आत्मा कम इन टू द पिक्चर? द जीव आत्मा इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द सुप्रीम डिवाइन, वॉट वी कॉल एज द ब्रह्म, सुप्रीम डिवाइन, all the names that you have got to understand. This knowledge is the divine knowledge. The moment you start attracting all the material worldly knowledge in your world, that is the lower knowledge. I am a boy, I am a girl, my name is so and so, I live in this world, I am educated, I am graduate, I am this, I am that, I live in this country, I have got this passport, oh my God, so many things. Think about it. Many years ago, 10,000 years ago, there was an ice age. And before that also, 10,000 years before that, there was another ice age. And before that also, there was another ice age. So many ice ages have happened. I'm sure you have seen that movie, isn't it? Ice Age. So they have part 1, part 2, part 3. Yes, I know. So now imagine you are a mammoth from that age. Which country do you belong to? You don't belong to any country at all. You are a mammoth. The mammoth doesn't have a country. Now he can take his herd, and create a country. You understand what I'm saying? So it happened 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years ago. People created a clump, you know, a small society kind of a thing, and somebody became the king, somebody became something, and so on and so forth, and they said, this is my territory. Just last month, when they were digging for ruins in Vietnam, they found a temple which has got Ganesha and relics from Mahabharata. It is so strange to see that. You know, people think Vietnam is so far away. Well, you go to Indonesia, you will find it there. You go to any part of this country on this side, you will find it there. Ganesha is also found in the Middle East. Is there even in the Gulf region? Yes. There was a town where the sailors would take a halt. It's at the juncture, okay, like this. At that point, every sailor from everywhere in the world would take a halt. These ships would take a halt over there. And they bought a lot of stuff. So they had taken all the way to Europe also. So in Europe also, you will find ruins from India. Today there are lots of people who are taking all the ruins all the way to America also. So does it mean that we were the only civilization? No. So there were lots of civilizations. The understanding has to be clear. So a wise man, first and foremost, now we are coming to wisdom. A wise man never makes judgments. He just takes the knowledge, which is the profound knowledge, and he becomes silent. Wisdom makes a person silent. Wisdom doesn't allow a person to open his mouth, because if you are sitting in front of the fools, what is the point in speaking out? Because nobody understands. So why should a wise man open his mouth? A wise man can pass on bits of knowledge, bits, little bits. Now these bits of knowledge cannot be assimilated or even digested by an average human being, because he really doesn't understand. First and foremost, it is very difficult for him to understand whether he is a human being or whether he is a spirit soul. So everything that happens to the human being, the unreal world, he takes it as real. The Maya's world is so strongly embedded in this person that he starts believing in any crap that happens in this world. So in this world, if I tell him, you know, there is a cat god, I worship the cat god. Hey, low cat god. And tomorrow that person will start believing in a cat god. With no knowledge, a person starts believing in the cat god. Now, if you really think that I am saying something wrong, please do something. Go to Google and find out about cat gods. The Egyptian and the civilization before them believed in cat gods. All right? So, did they have other jackals? Of course they had jackals also. What makes you think not? They had that also. Have you seen the film of Moses where he parts that? Have you seen that? What does he do? Where does he get the tablets from? Not for coronavirus, but tablets from the mountaintop, isn't it? So have you not seen all those people dancing and, you know, singing and all that? And then he goes up the mountain and he brings those golden tablets. Okay, isn't it? So this will give you an understanding that people can believe in anything that they wish to. Wisdom is that which will tell you the truth. The truth about being. Who you are, what you are not a body. This knowledge, when a person imbibes, becomes silent. He doesn't open his mouth. Because there is nobody to speak to. He has become the self. Self is alone. And when the person merges in the divine, an Atma is become one with the divine. So he becomes Paramatma himself, isn't it? As a Paramatma, whom is he supposed to report to? You think he has Paramatma as some wife or somebody like that? No. He's alone. He's one. So this knowledge and wisdom are very, very difficult subjects to understand. Those who are wise will always be silent. They may not talk much. So if you go and sit in front of, say, Ramana Maharshi, he is not even going to open his mouth. He may say one or two words, that's it. Have you ever seen any scriptures from the past which just say one or two words? If you go to a Shiva Sutra, two words makes one sutra. And it contains fantastic knowledge. As of those who can understand are called wise people. Those who don't understand are called ignorant people. Alright? So everybody in this world who is thinking of the material worldly knowledge are ignorant. And those who can think of all the things which are connected to the Supreme Divine Consciousness or as you are, that spirit soul, whatever they are connected to that world are the wise ones. So I think I have given a spiritual explanation of what is wisdom and what is knowledge. And what is this mundane knowledge from the material world? What is divine knowledge? Alright? So we'll move to the next one. The next one is slightly different question. Yes. The question is sadhana. Alright? How do we know which sadhana is best for us? Which sadhana is best for the human being? I will tell you something which I have read today morning itself. Krishna has said a few words. I think maybe I will read it out to you so you will understand it better. It is from the Uddhav Gita and this is chapter 18, I think, verse 58. There is a person who goes around trying to find out all the things from about God. After he gets kicked around in every which way, he tries to find out, how do I know God? So he comes to this last understanding. He says, verse 58, so I shall practice this devotion to the Supreme Self, which the great sages of the old had recourse to. And only worshipping the feet of the Lord, I shall cross the limitless wilderness of ignorance. You may go right round the world. Now, this is a big chapter. And in that chapter, Krishna answers him also. Krishna says, this was a song sung by the sage who, having lost his wealth and gets disgusted with the world, wanders over the earth like a monk, free from anxiety and, though insulted by the wicked, remains unshaken in the path of duty. The world consisting of friends, neutrals and foes, which affects a man with pleasure and pain, is a phantasm of the mind, owing to ignorance and nothing but that. I just now explained in the previous question that everything that you see, whether it is your relative, whether it's a person, whether it's an animal or whatever, is nothing but a phantasm of the mind. If it is all unreal, then what are you actually searching for? Do you really think that you can gain the knowledge of the divine in any other way? So what is the sadhana best for a human being today? I am going to tell you straight away, because I am doing number of books, from the Bhagavad Gita to the Uddhav Gita to Bhagavatam to you name it, you know. And all the sages and saints of this world who are really great sages and saints, like Ramakrishna, Paramahansa, to Sai Babas, to Kabir, to you name it, you know, all the great names that you can think of, including the Sufi saints of all times, including the English saints, basically I should call them the Christian saints or Catholic saints or whatever. Whoever has come in this world has only said one thing. You don't have such a great knowledge that you can become a jnana yogi. You can never. You have got such a small, tiny knowledge inside of you. Karma yoga is very difficult to follow. Raj yoga is impossible to do. You can try whatever you want to. This man whose story I was talking about just now tried out pranayama, tried out yogasana, tried out going to the jungles and doing all kinds of austerities, also finally failed in everything. And if Krishna is telling this story, he is telling you straightforward that there is only one way in which you can overcome your mind. And that path is the path of devotion. So any sadhana that you do, the results are not going to be good, because you are always going to stumble. If you follow the path of Sankhya Yoga, your ego is coming in the way. The moment you start spouting knowledge at people, you know, you start throwing this knowledge and that knowledge. The moment a person throws knowledge at people, it's a gone case. Because you can see ego standing right in front of you. Ego means the mind. I know this, I know this, I know this. I was listening to a very beautiful satsang given by a very great sage. And the last few, is no more. The question asked to him was whether Sanskrit is important for knowing. And in that he said, if I can tell you all the names of the sages and saints who have become great in this world, from Ramakrishna Paramahansa, who had not even read the Bhagavad Gita. He had no knowledge about Sanskrit. Kabir had zero knowledge about Sanskrit. Mirabai had no knowledge of Sanskrit. Let us go backward in time. Let us go to Buddha. You think Buddha had knowledge about Sanskrit? Zero knowledge about Sanskrit. The two languages that he spoke was Magadhi, Pali, and you know, all those others. There was no Sanskrit there. The South Indian sages, they spoke in Tamil. That was an ancient language. It's as ancient as Sanskrit for that matter. So by learning Sanskrit or by trying to by heart some verses, do you really think you are making some great progress? You are just a pandit. You're not Pandit ji. You're just a Pandit. You can just spout verses, but no knowledge. And the moment you start quoting verses after verses and saying, I can quote this verse, I can quote that verse, I'm sorry, your ego has come very much into the picture. No. Karma Yoga is difficult to manage because, for a very simple reason, human beings are always expecting something or the other. You cannot say, I am doing selfless service. Can you say that? You are working for a company, you are working in this world. Do you think you should not get paid? I think you should be. Because you have a family to look after, you have your own food to eat, isn't it? And if anything is connected to that, then it is not karma at all. So you are dependent on results. That goes out of the window again. Those who follow a very strict path, going through, doing all kinds of meditation, is there anybody on this planet Earth who can say that my meditation is going to, the result is going to stay with me throughout my life? Not a single person can vouch for that. Because meditation is like going up to Himalayas. You can't stay on the shikhar, on the top point over there for long. You got to come down. You have to be with people. You have to come down and tell everybody. They are going to ask you, how was it up there? What are you going to tell them? So meditative state is a tiny state. You can touch it, come down. Touch it, come down. That's it. You can never live in that bliss forever. So that leaves us with only one path. And that path is called devotion. There is no requirement as such over here. Devotional path is so simple. Just be lost in God. Single pointed devotion to God. Unconditional love to Him. Of course you can go and work. You can go and earn money. You can be in the material world. You can become a president of the country also. You can do whatever you want to. It really doesn't matter. You have to do it in a detached spirit. Being completely dispassionate about things, even if you have $1 billion in your name, don't bother about it. And maybe you will make $1 trillion also. That also you should not be bothered. Because it comes, it goes. It comes, it goes, isn't it? Sometimes you have it, sometimes you don't. What difference does it make? It should not disturb you. So you can join anything, do anything for that matter. A path of devotion is like that. You can sit on a mountain top and just take the name of Ram. Doesn't matter. So, the best sadhana anybody can do is just follow the guru. He will guide you on the way and they said, go do this. He may just tell you to wash clothes, you know, for all you know. Does it matter? What did he tell Totaka? Nothing. Nothing. Just do my work. Right? And he was the greatest of the sages. So do you get the point? It's not necessary for any person to do anything really great or spectacular in devotional path. Devotional path is the easiest, simplest and achievable. So I would suggest that the best path is devotional path, and the sadhana connected to the devotional path is what we are doing in the Das Bodh. So now let us go to the next one, which is called Das Bodh. All right, so let us see. We are doing the fourth dashaka. This is chapter 5. The chapter 5 is called worship. It's a small chapter, but we'll see. In the last chapter, we have described the fourth type of devotion. Now we will describe the fifth way of devotion, to which you may please listen with attention. The fifth type of devotion is worship. Worship means ritual offering to God, which should be in accordance with the standard laid down in the scriptures. Worshipping the divine, there is a process. There is a way in which our scriptures have laid down certain rules and regulations and the way how you can go about doing it. So here Samartha Ramdas is going to discuss about the different ways in which you can do worship of God. In worship, we have to provide various mattings for seat, apaparatas, clothes, ornaments, decorations, perform mental worship, meditation on the image. This is the fifth type of devotion, that the worship covers all this. Right from sitting where you are, the place where you sit for devotional purposes, isn't it? The seat, the worshipping seat. And that has importance. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says very clearly, if you have something made of kusa grass, there's a beautiful verse where Krishna says, if you can sit on the kusa grass. You have seen some of the great sages and saints, they use animal skin, you know, to sit on it. Some use the tiger skin, some use the elephant skin. There are so many, but today, please don't do any of those things. It is not good. Wildlife people will come running after you. Don't you even dare do that. So what is it that you can sit on in today's day and age? It's a raised platform. Just try to sit on a slightly raised, elevated platform. So we will come to all these things. Then the clothes that you wear. What are the clothes that you wear? First and foremost, they have to be clean. You can wear anything, or you can be sitting naked also for the puja. Doesn't really matter. You may have just applied a bhasma on top of your body also. Because I have certain very good swamis as friends who sit naked doing puja. I'm not joking. And they are really very great people. And they apply bhasma all over their body. I refuse to go and meet them because they tell me, you have to do this. I am not going to do this. So it's difficult to go and say hello to them also. Because in their ashram, you have to be naked roaming all over the town. Okay? And that is something some people are not used to. So let us come to the way that you dress up. It's important to dress up in a particular manner. Now, when you are worshipping, you need some ornaments for the God, not for you. Otherwise, tomorrow you will say, Guruji said, you know, I should wear all the ornaments possible and sit for the puja. It's not about you. If you wear ornaments, that is your greed. You have to give ornaments to the gods. Make them, you know, nice ornaments for them. They are available in the marketplace, or you can make them. Right. And there are lots of things that go along with it, like that. You can do mental worship also, of course. Now we move to the next verse. Worship of God, Brahmin, fire, sage, saint, guest, yati, highly experienced sage, the Gayatri. These are five types, the fifth type of devotion. Who are we supposed to be doing the worship for? He says, worship of God, worship of the Brahman. Brahman means the knower of Brahma, the one who is perfect in knowledge. Fire, we can worship the fire. We can worship the sage or the saint. Guest. Any guest who comes, a guest has to be treated like God. A yati. A highly experienced sage. Gayatri. You know Gayatri mantra and all that. In this, there is a worship of images made of metal, stone, clay, picture, painting, worship of worthy persons and worship of the image of gods in your home. So these are the various things. You can have a metal image, you can have a wooden image, you can have whatever image that you want to have. The various symbols or things and articles are also worshipped. Among them are stone pieces with 7 or 9 markings. Oblong stones which are called shaligrams with small coral figures of circular shape on them. Phallic symbol stones called Suryakanta, Chandrakanta, Bana, Tandale, stones found in the river Narmada. I think we have gathered a lot of stones wherever we go. I don't know where they are. But yes, the best stone that anybody can gather from anywhere is called shaligram. Now, what is a shaligram? Do you know shaligram is a small creature from the sea? It is called ammonoid. Ammonites, as it's called. It is more than 300 to 600 million years old. And where is it found? It is a sea creature. It is a creature from the sea. A tiny creature to a big one also. It is a sea creature. It's supposed to be in the oceans. And it is found in Nepal. Which will tell you that how can Shaligram be found in Nepal? Okay. It's a fossil of an ammonoid. This fossil is found in a river called Gandaki. Now, Gandaki River is a river which flows through Nepal. And if you go to Nepal, you can see people selling all these kinds of Shaligram. You can open it and see. Some of them are broken. Some of them are not. I have shown you all in my past satsangs an open ammonoid. You know, I've shown you an open Shaligram. Inside that was a creature. I have a couple of Shaligrams which are not opened. They are small stones. They are like egg-like things. So you can, you know, pray to a Shaligram. Shaligram is representation of Vishnu. That is his name. By the way, when I was a kid, looking at my color, I used to be called Shaligram also. It's a black color stone. So it was the person who used to call me was one of the greatest stage artists. His name was Bhatodekar. So Mr. Bhatodekar, whenever he met me, he said, Shaligram, how are you doing? And all that. Anyway, it's a long story. So Shaligrams can be worshipped. So every house can keep Shaligrams. Try to get a Shaligram which is not broken. Try to get. These are found in Nepal. Gandaki is the name of the river. And these are fossils which are 300 million years old. So, you know, and they came from the sea. There was no land called India at that time. India was a part of another continent called Africa. Okay? It was another continent. The part of India broke away from this big landmass of Africa and came and smashed against the Asia. Bang! And that is the reason why when the land was like this and this land came from, let us say, from the African region, and when it came and dashed against it, it created a mountain. And that is called the Himalayas. Himalayas are still having fossils from as old as millions and millions of years ago. You can find fantastic fossils over there. And which creatures you are finding them? The sea creatures, the fishes and all those things. So you can find them. So there was no land called India, by the way. India came into the picture just, should I say, recent past of this earth. Very good. So let us continue from there and move from Shaligram ahead. So there are various symbols which you can worship. The phallic symbol, which is basically, representation of Shiva. Stones like Suryakant, Chandrakant, Bana, Tandale, and river stones. Like if you go to some of the holy rivers, when you do the Narmada Parikrama, you will find at certain places there are very beautiful round stones. You can collect from them. You have to know the right kind of stones. So from the Narmada Parikrama, you can find these stones and they can be worshipped also. There are gods like Bhairav, Bhagwati, Malhari, Munja, Nrushina, Banashankari, various symbols of cobra, coins which are worshipped. There is a worship of Panchayatana, which Panchayatana means there are five, you know, you keep 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there are 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the fifth one in the center. The center one is called Ganesha. On the top, now where you keep the Ganesha in the center, on this side, on the top, his father is going to sit. On this side over here, his mother is going to sit. Below him is sitting on this side Vishnu. And on this side is Surya Dev. So people, those who are from the Smartha sect, Smartha, now they worship these things. It's called Panchayatana. You can definitely study it and get an answer on that. So So we are not discussing that over here. So I just gave you an understanding of how this whole thing works. There are gods which people worship called Ganesha, Sharda, Vitthala, Ranganatha, Jagannath, Dancing Shankar, that is, Sriranga, Hanumanta, Garuda. The following images can be worshipped. The images of incarnations like Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narsimha, Vamana, Bhargava, Rama, Krishna and Hayagriva. So any of these avatars, you can bring pictures or small images. If you are having a small home, then bring metal images or images made of small stones or something like that. If you are having a very big place where you are going to build a temple or something like that, then you have to make images of stone. Then the stone images, because they have to be worshipped in a different fashion. And understand one thing, if you bring an image home, you can put it up just like that. But when you bring an image which is quite big, there is a ceremony that has to be performed. Only the priests will be able to guide you on these ceremonies. Because they have to dig a particular thing, they have to put certain metals and so on and so forth. And no glue is used, by the way. No glue is to be used. Not the artificial glues like araldite and all. You don't use that. No. They make glue. They will make glue over there in front of you. And that is what is used. If you ever come to the ashram over here, I will be able to show you how it is done. So you can see over here. Alright, so all these big images, they have to be set differently. Small images, you can bring them, metal and all, you can bring and keep them. The various images include Keshava, Narayana, Madhava, Govind, Vishnu, Madhusudana, Trivikrama, Vaman, Sridhar, Rishikesh, Padmanabh, Damodar, Shankarshana, Vasudev, Pradyumna, Anirudh, Purushottama, Adghokshaja, Narsimha, Achyut, Janardana and Upendra. These are basically avatars of Krishna himself. Many images of Hari and Hara, that is Vishnu and Shiva, Bhagavanta, Jagadmata, Jagdish, Shiv, Shakti should be worshipped. So any of the, it's not necessarily that you don't say tomorrow, you know, get all the images and put in front of you. No, one is all that you need. Okay, representation. That's it. Okay, then we move to the next one. Ashwatha, Narayana, Surya Narayana, Lakshmi Narayana, Trimalla Narayana, Sri Hari Narayana, Adi Narayana, Shesha Shai Paramatma. That is the reclining Vishnu. Such and other images of gods are many. They should all be worshipped. This is the fifth type of devotion. Worshipping the images. There are some families who do not keep any images at all. That is also perfect. They can pray to the unmanifest divinity as well. There is a Brahmo Samaj, they pray to the unmanifest divinity. They are allowed to do so. It's not that their devotion is going to come down any which way. It is just worshipping a deity, a divinity, a form is better to focus on to it. You see, when you are praying to the unmanifest, you don't even know what you are doing. You know, you may be singing songs of some films while you are doing that. For all you know, it's not, you don't even know what you are going to do because you can't see anything, right? So that is the reason why form is important. So you can get a form and worship it. It doesn't matter which one. Alright, in addition to this, there are various family traditions of ceremonies and worship. They should be performed according to their order. It may be that some are of high or middle order. Now this knowledge only your forefathers can give you. I cannot give you this knowledge. You have to ask your great-grandfathers, grandfathers, grandmothers or whoever that is there living in the family right now. Ask them, how were they worshipping the gods in the past? A small side note, once we had gone to see a very beautiful house. This was in Goa. And the person who owned that house had such beautiful images and pictures kept over there, and they were so beautiful, but the house was locked for many, many years. And the whole thing was just lying like that. I requested that person to give me that house so that we can do the puja over there. Unfortunately, we were not able to do anything about it. I don't know what has happened to the house. It was a very beautiful, you know, more than 200, 300 years old house. With beautiful images. Now, you are not supposed to leave an image just like that and walk away. Please know that. It's the same going for Ganesha. If you anytime get Ganesha at home, you cannot stop that activity. It is written in the scriptures that if you bring the image of Ganesha during the Ganesh Chaturthi, you know, we get the images of Ganesha. You have to continue because it's a parampara. It is a tradition in that particular household. They have to do it. And it continues from, you know, as you pass on the legacy, it continues. So even the sons and after them, the grandchildren also have to do. You cannot stop it. If you have to stop it, there is a certain methods which have been prescribed. I wouldn't know that, so you may have to ask someone. All right. The names are Jakhamata, Mayarani, Bala, Bagula, Manavini, Mangini, Jogini. These deities come under family traditions. They should also be worshipped. These are different kinds of goddesses that come under certain traditional players in this field. That is, let's say for example, if you are somewhere in the central India, Bagula is important. She goes by the name Bagalamukhi and Matangi and various other forms are there of goddesses which have been worshipped. So some of the goddesses which I don't know who can worship them, like Tripurari and all, they are very difficult to worship. I wouldn't know who is worshipping them. Many places of pilgrimages should be visited. The deity there should be worshipped by various offerings. Okay, various articles. In such articles includes Panchamrut. Alright. Paste of sandalwood, colored rice, flowers, various scented things like loban, lighting of lamps like niranjan with ghee and wick and camphor. Now the first word over here is Panchamrut. Pancha, five. Amrut. What are the five things that you need to do? First is milk. You know, milk is supposed to be pure. When you are using milk, it has to be not boiled. Kacha. Kacha means raw milk. Okay. That is number one. Number two, you have to use curd. Now, the curd has to be set separately. Okay. Not the curd that you buy from the marketplace. You can set it separately. All right. Third is madhu. Madhu means, what do you call madhu? Honey is to be used. Now three have gone. Then the fourth one is sugar. The sugar that you get, clean sugar, of course. In olden times, they used to use a little bit of jaggery in the past, but sugar is to be used. And then there is a last one called ghee. You know, ghee is the purest one of all. So these five ingredients have to be mixed together to make a panchamrut. All right? Five ingredients. I've told them to you. So milk, honey, curd, ghee and sugar. Five things. Alright? Then are various eatables, various fruits, tambul, paan. That paan means the betel leaf. Coins, ornaments, fine clothes, garlands, forest flowers. Shibikas, umbrellas, palanquins, canopy, totem with an image of sun, flags with small sticks, banners, symbols, mridangs, etc. Some of them are instruments, some of them are flags. Those kind of things are a part and parcel of it. Various beat instruments can be used. Many ceremonies with great gatherings of devotees in which there is a Haridasa, singing with devotion to God, may be arranged. That means you can also arrange for kirtans. We have done kirtans before in third chapter. The following may be provided as an offering to God. Now, what is it that you can offer to God? So nowadays, you don't offer any of these things because it's little out of... You are sitting in a city and I don't think you can dig a well in the city. Okay, the first one is a well. You can dig a well. Small wells, lakes, temples with high elevations, square yards which are beautiful, Vrindavan, that is the tulsi plant in the central place, and tunnels. This was in olden times during the time of Samartha Ramdas that this could be done, but not today. Today it is a little bit difficult. Yes, you can do the rest of this also, which is called monastery, canopy, inns, resting places near temples, small and big utensils, garlands of stones of planets and star constellations and various dresses. These are offerings that can be given. That is, sometimes you can build a monastery, if you are so rich, of course, canopies, inns, rest houses and all, inns where a person travels. So there is a lot of other things. Drapery, curtains and all that. Veils, constructions of temporary pandals, beautiful applique work, wall hangings made of jewels. Even elephants, horses, carts should be offered in various temples. I don't think you can offer elephants today, but in some of the temples around the world, like say for example in Thailand, in Kerala, in Tamil Nadu and all, they definitely have elephants over there. So you can see the elephants here, even in Karnataka, of course. Right. Decorations, ornaments and boxes for keeping them, articles for offering and pots for keeping them. Food and water and vessels for keeping them should be provided. So any of these things you can give. Gardens, flower beds, huts for persons doing penance should also be provided for this type of worship of the Lord of the world. For temples, the following animals and birds can be supplied. Parrots, sarika, peacocks, duck, charawak, chakor, cuckoos, antelopes, elk, not allowed. For to temples should be given kasturi deers, cats. By the way, these things are not allowed by the Wildlife Protection Act. So don't you dare do that, okay? Don't. Otherwise, tomorrow you'll get one deer and say and an elk over here and say, here, I'm giving it to the temple. You know, you can go to jail and even the person who accepts it can go. This is coming under the Wildlife Protection Act. You cannot offer these kind of things. These are laws of the land. We cannot do anything about them. Right. For temples should be given kasturi deers. Again, not allowed. Cats, cows, buffaloes, bulls, monkeys and various things. And also own children should be sent to do service in the temples. Yeah, sometimes children are told, you know, go and do this service in the temples. By devotion, by worship means one should worship God by physical work, by doing propaganda, singing in praise, using the speech, by mind, meditation, by consciousness, constantly thinking about God, by money, donations, etc., by soul and pranas, and not sparing an effort in the service of God. So any of these kind of services can also be done. Similar to the worship of God, we should worship Sadguru with one-pointed faith. This is the fifth type of devotion. Worshipping the Sadguru, that is the Guru that you have, you can do devotional service unto him. That is the fourth chapter we had done already, right? If such a worship is not possible, one should worship mentally because God likes that very much. If you worship mentally also, God likes it. That means you may be sitting in a train and you can worship him there as well. It doesn't matter that you can, you have to sit in only in one place. Maybe you are sitting in a plane and just, Lord, please sit.